Hello there! Welcome to yet another devlog about a game I'm making with my own engine, where the goal is to build a peaceful and prosperous village. The game is still in an early development stage, and currently I'm working towards a demo that would showcase roughly the first hour of gameplay. We ended the last devlog with a system that makes the villagers actually sleep at night. They can sleep right on the ground, but they prefer something cozier like this simple hay beddings. This is just one of many natural needs of the villagers. The next one that I worked on is getting tired or resting. I consider this to be a system separate from sleeping. While the need to sleep is always increasing if the villager isn't sleeping, the need to rest is only increasing when the villager is doing some work. You can think of it as some kind of energy or stamina that the villager has. They can restore it by just sitting on the ground, or for example sitting on a fallen tree stump. This leads to a behavior when, after a villager chops down a tree, which is quite a tiresome thing to do, they immediately sit down on the freshly appeared tree stump to have some rest, and I think it's quite cute. Of course, sleeping also counts as resting, so in the morning all villagers are full of energy and ready to work. If for some reason a villager depletes all their energy, they just pass out, which then counts as sleeping so that they can still restore some energy. Now, there's a final natural need that I wanted to work on, which is hunger. Right now we just have one type of food in the game, which is roasted mushrooms. I implemented all the required bits, and now the villagers try to find food whenever they get hungry. And if they stay hungry for too long, they pass out as well. This time forever, since there's no way for them to eat while they're unconscious. Of course, in the future this should be replaced by something like a malnutrition state that affects their health, but passing out will do for now. By the way, this is the first time when I've added something that actually punishes the player, and turns this kind of sandbox into something more like a game prototype. As you can see, a lot of early gameplay revolves around the forests. You can find your first food and building materials here. However, it really bothers me that you basically can't see inside the forest, only if you tilt the camera really low, which isn't exactly the most convenient user interface. So, I implemented a way to hide the treetops so that I can actually see what's going on under the trees. It uses blue noise dithering and it doesn't look perfect, but it's much better than nothing. I couldn't use true transparency here, because it requires sorting objects by their distance to camera, which is extremely bad for performance. Then, I had an idea on how to improve my area selection tools. A lot of people suggested doing simple rectangular selection, but it's not as simple as it seems. My game uses a triangular grid, and rectangles don't really mean anything here. If, on the other hand, I used a screen space rectangle, this would require me to find all objects currently visible through this rectangle, which in turn requires some spatial data structures. This is certainly doable, but it still feels like an unnecessary complication. I also want all the in-game tools to be somehow based on the triangular grid, so that the player can get used to it much quicker. So, the option I came up with is something like painting your selection area onto the map. It's still not perfect, but after a lot of testing I think it does the job quite well. I've also added these highlights on the selection border. They're made of individual triangles, each of which is a separate in-game entity, so that it's extremely easy for me to create and modify them. At the same time, my engine is highly optimized for this kind of stuff, so them being individual entities doesn't really hurt the performance. One thing about this game is that I want it to be possible to automate almost everything. Ideally, you should be able to set up all the production chains in such a way that the village can survive without any further input from the player, if nothing unexpected happens. Right now, you have to explicitly select all the mushrooms to be harvested, which isn't really scalable. To fix that, I added these auto-harvesting zones. The villagers will now automatically harvest anything that grows here. In the future, when I'll finally have some UI, you'll also be able to automatically chop trees here or change what should be harvested and what shouldn't. There's one more problem with roasting mushrooms, which is that currently the villagers can do that even if the fire already went out. So I added some code so that the villagers will automatically refuel the campfire before crafting something on it, and they also have the option to just keep it burning all the time. Eating roasted mushrooms all the time is a bit dull, so I decided to add some more forageable food, like these blueberry bushes. The model is of course pretty basic, and it probably needs at least some color gradients here and there, but overall I'm quite happy with it. It seems to have just the right amount of detail density. It looks a bit weird compared to these blobby trees, but I'm planning to redo the tree models quite soon. Now blueberries spawn on these bushes from time to time, and the villagers can harvest and eat them. My whole game is based on a pattern called Entity Component System, and it turned out to be so flexible that sometimes the villagers would go and eat berries directly from the bush, which is something they were never programmed to do. It was a bug, of course, but quite a funny one. Now, harvesting berries one by one is a bit stupid. In fact, I'm planning to make item containers and transportation to be an important part of the game. For this, I made a nice woven basket model. This took me quite some time because it's way off my 3D modeling comfort zone of just extruding a few cylinders. Though later I decided that it's just way too detailed and doesn't quite suit the game, so I made another model with roughly the same shape but with less detail. Then I added a crafting recipe for it, specifically it requires 10 wooden sticks. The villagers can now craft a basket on a tree stump and use it to harvest food. While implementing all this, I found myself in the need of yet another system. You see, right now all the resources on the map belong to the player, and a villager in need of a resource will search the whole map for it. It can be useful at start, but then it gets really annoying when they go to the other end of the map just to bring something. This will get even more annoying when I introduce stockpiles, and the villagers will be constantly gathering all the map's resources. In games like Dwarf Fortress, Rimworld, or Going Medieval, you can claim or allow naturally occurring items one by one, which in particular solves this problem. And that's exactly what I implemented as well, adding a special tool to claim resources for the player. Non-player resources aren't highlighted in any way just yet, I'm still thinking about how to do that in a way that doesn't produce too much visual noise. Lastly, I decided to work a bit on the terrain. You see, slopes and height differences are quite important for this game, since most things can only be built on a flat surface. However, right now all these tiny slopes are almost impossible to see. To fix that, I essentially increased the tessellation level of the terrain and tweaked the normals so that the various slopes would stand out more. This also allowed me to add some more color variation on the terrain. Now the grid tiles that the game works on are visible, but they're still nuanced enough so as not to look too noisy. Quite amusingly, the boundary between different terrain types turned out to look like the well-known Koch snowflake fractal, which isn't something I was planning to do, but I think I like how it looks. Oh, and I tweaked the shadows a bit, so that the shadow projection better corresponds to the visible area. Now I can actually see that this stick is lying on the ground, and this mushroom is growing from the ground and not flying in the air. Of course, this means that far away shadows look completely off, but that will do for now. In the future, I'll definitely implement cascaded shadows or something like that. So, that's it for today. We're making huge progress, even if I'm still quite far from a playable demo. In the meantime, the best way to support this game is to like this video, subscribe to the channel, and tell your friends about it. And I'll see you in the next devlog.